Hello everyone. Welcome back to the session on your mask for a system. So this is related to your unit 5, which is nothing but your file storage management system. So in this we are going to discuss about the different type of storage systems what we have, how the scheduling actually takes place in this particular storage systems and all. Okay, this is the second part of your course 15. So in this particular session, so we will be discussing about the overview of your mask storage structure. So in which we will be discussing about the different type of storage devices what we have. In the first unit, we discussed about the storage hierarchy. If you remember, we discussed about the storage hierarchy. So in which initially you have something called as registers that we have seen in the previous unit. And after that we discussed about cache. And then we had something called RAM. And then finally like this, and in the end we have something called as magnetic disk. Right, so we have seen the hierarchy similar to this. So here we have magnetic disk, and then we have magnetic tape, and so on. So in this particular session, this particular overview of mask storage structure, we'll be discussing about something called as this hierarchy. So the first portion, first register, cache, and RAM, we discussed in the previous unit, that is the third unit, where we have discussed about the memory management techniques. But in this particular unit, we'll be discussing about something called as magnetic disk, magnetic tapes, and how this works. That part we are going to cover in the first one. That is nothing but overview of mask storage structure. Then we have something called a disk structure. So what are the different structures we do have related to the disk representation, and how these disk structures are shown, that we are going to see in this particular disk. And then finally we'll discuss, talk about the disk attachment, how we are going to attach this particular disk to our system. Like if you talk about the laptop, how the secondary hard disk, your secondary storage device is connected to your laptop. And the same way how your other, if you talk about a server here, the server, how the this particular disk is attached to the server. Definitely the way the disk has been attached to the server is entirely different from the way the disk are attached to your laptops. Okay, so here disk is nothing but your secondary storage device. The secondary storage, okay, the disk here, you remember that it is nothing but your secondary. It is a secondary storage device, whatever we are using, okay, in order to store the data. And we know that it is a non-volatile in nature, right? So even though there is a power failure or there is a loss of power, whatever the data you people are writing in this particular secondary storage, it will not get eliminated or it cannot get deleted. But if you talk about RAM, so definitely the data will get deleted. So finally, the last but not the least is disk scheduling we are going to discuss about. So in the disk scheduling, what we are going to learn is how this particular what are the data we are trying to access from this secondary storage device, how the system is going to get that access. So that definitely we require scheduling, same like your process scheduling, we have disk scheduling. So here also we have some few different type of scheduling will be coming across. So let's begin the discussion with your first one, overview of a mask storage structure. So in the first one, what we are going to discuss about here is the magnetic disk. If you talk about the magnetic disk here, let me show you the diagram. Yeah, this is. So basically, magnetic disk, whatever we are talking about here, this magnetic disk is nothing but it's a bulk of storage of for a modern computer system. So whichever the modern systems we can see nowadays, like your laptops, your hard disk and all, it actually consists of a secondary storage device. And we know that what is the capacity of a secondary storage device? Well, in the traditional systems, we used to have some hardware like a MBs. And later on, it went into GBs, and now it has entered into TVs. Like you can see that there are several different type of magnetic secondary storage devices available. We have the hard disk available, which is of size 1 TB or 2 TB, right? We are able to get. Earlier it was like in GBs, like something called as a 500 GB, something like that we used to have. But nowadays we are having 1 TB and 2 TB amount of data we can be provided. So what this particular hard disk actually consists of? The magnetic disk inside that particular hard drive. I don't know how many of you have seen the hard disk. Okay, so if you see the hard disk, you can see that within that you will be having these kind of cylindrical thing. You can see this is the actual diagram of your magnetic disk. If you see, let me space some time for executing this particular diagram so that it becomes easy for you to understand. If you see here, this particular magnetic disk actually consists of a platter. Okay. So this particular thing, whatever you people are seeing here, this CD is what we usually call it as a platter. And basically it is of what shape? It's a flat surface. You can see here it is a flat surface, okay? And on the both the sides of this particular platter, a magnetic coating is done. On the both the sides of this particular packet, I mean platter, a magnetic coating is done. And this is where we are going to store our data, okay? So within the hard disk, whatever we are using it, it actually consists of magnetic disk inside. And there will not be a single CD here. You can see there are multiple CDs present here. Let us suppose this is for 500 GB. This is a 500 GB hard disk. So these all, so with that particular box, rectangle box, what we have hard disk, that actually consists of this particular disk. And this disk is nothing but the usual platter. And every platter on the top and the bottom, it is actually covered with this surface, and the bottom surface is covered with a magnetic material. And whatever the data we want to store, that will be stored within this particular magnetic material. Now, since you can see there are multiple platters present here, okay, now these platters will actually consist of tracks. Tracks are nothing but layers. We can also call it as layers here. These particular CDs will consist of tracks like this. Okay, I will show you the diagrammatic part here. You can see. So suppose this is a C, this is your disk, okay, magnetic disk. Now within this disk, you people will have layers like this. Let us suppose this is the first layer. And then we have a second layer like this. Then you might be having a third layer. And then finally the fourth layer. Well, the diagram is not clear, but still you can understand. So if you see here, the disk, even your CD, if you take an example of your CD or DVD, you might have seen. If you see properly the surface of that particular CD and DVD, you will see a several different type of layers. Okay, and within that layer, that is actually coated with some kind of magnetic material. And within that layer, we are going to store the data. So whenever we want to store the data, first we'll try to cover this layer. Whatever the data is present, that we will be writing here. Once this is done, then we'll go to the next layer. So it will be from outside to inside, okay? It will never be, we will never never write data from inside to outside. We will be writing from outer layer, and then slowly we'll be entering into the inner surface. This is the way how we exactly write the code, okay? The data into your hard disk. So here, this particular layer is what we are generally calling it as a track, okay? So every layer, whatever we have, we call it as a track. You can see here, we are written here track. And this track will further be subdivided into a sector. So within the sector, we'll first try to complete. So every track will consist of multiple number of sectors. And every sector, we will be writing some data. So once this particular sector is filled, then we'll move to the next sector. Once that particular sector is filled, then we'll move to the next sector. So this is the way how we exactly write it up. Now, in between, you can see that there is a spindle. We call it as a spindle. There is a rod here. Okay, this is a rod. Okay. So this rod is used for rotation purpose. Actually, whenever you people might have seen, whenever you insert a CD drive, so you might have seen that whenever you insert a CD, what happens is it automatically starts spinning. In the same way, whenever you want to write the data, these particular platters should spin simultaneously. How that can be spinned here is with the help of this particular spindle. Using the spindle, we will be rotating it. So this driver will rotate the spindle with a very high speed. So generally it is around 60 to 250 times per second. So per second it spins this particular spinner around 60 to 250 times. Well, if you talk about the standard one, if you talk about a standard, how we can measure the speed of this particular spinner is, it depends upon RPM. We actually measure it based upon your RPM, rotation per minute. Okay, so generally the standard one are around 5,400. It can be some. Further, we have something called 7,200. Okay, we have different RPMs. 5,400, 7,200. We also have 10,000. Okay, and finally, we have even 15,000 rotations per minute. Even that also we are having. So based upon this particular, so it depends upon the system, whatever we are using, based on that, this particular RPM keeps on varying. If you're using a very high-end configuration, if you're using, definitely the RPM will be much more higher. If you are using a low-end configuration, definitely the rotations per minute might be less, okay? So we have different types of RPMs here, like 5,400, 7,200, 10,000 RPM is there, and 15,000 RPM is there. So basically here we are talking about a standard one. So since we are here, so it will be running around 60 to 250 times per second. Now, this particular track will consist of multiple sectors. Now, every platter will consist of these particular tracks, right? Now, we also have within the hard disk this particular ARM assembly, and this will consist of this particular concept called as read-write head. It actually, every cylinder means this particular 3D type or whatever you're saying, a platter, will consist of a read-write head. This is the one who is responsible for making or writing the data or reading the data from this particular sector. So whatever the sectors are there, we are going to write the data. And whenever I want to read the data from the sectors, that can be done using this particular read-write head. Okay, and it is connected to this particular disk arm. Now, basically, the size, whatever the platter we are talking about here, this platter generally has some thickness. So, how much thickness it generally has is nothing but it's around 1.8. So, 1.8 to 3.5 inches, not more than that. Remember that? Whatever the thickness of this particular platter, of each platter is around 1.8 to 3.5 in thickness. Okay. So whenever you want to write the data, this particular disk arm will be moving this read-write head to that particular sector, and simultaneously they will start writing the data. And moreover, every track of each, if you see here, the track, this track of every platter will form a cylinder. You can see here, there is a cylinder formation here. You can see here, with every track of that particular thing, whatever is there in every platter, that will form a cylinder. Like if I take another one, let us take this particular layer track. This track I'm talking about, the next track. So what happens here? Now this will form another cylinder. Then if I talk, if I take another one here, last one here. Here. Now this will form another track. This is what we call it, an another cylinder. So this is the way how the cylinder actually works. Okay. So this is what we call it as a cylindrical format. So whenever we want to write simultaneously within all the platters, we people are going to write the data. Now this particular thing, whatever the read-write head we are talking about here, this read-write head is actually present very, there is a small, very light, small gap exists between this particular platter and the read-write head. Okay, maybe some small air gap is there, that's it. And sometimes there is a possibility whenever we flip, spinning, I mean we are rotating this particular spindle with a very high speed, sometimes there is a possibility that this particular read-write head pointer may touch this particular platter. And whenever it is touching this particular platter, then suddenly what happens here is, there is a possibility that it may damage that particular platter. And in that case, what happens here is, we cannot replace these particular CDs separately. This particular platter, whatever you're seeing, we cannot separate them separately. We, if any one of the platters damaged, we have to replace the entire hard disk. That much delicate it is. So this pointer, there is a possibility that sometimes it may try to damage this particular platter, whatever we are having. So in that case, what we need to do is, that particular damage is what we call it as head crash. So whenever this particular read-write pointer touches this particular platter, and it may damage the coating, magnetic coating of this particular read-write head, this particular platter, then that is what we call it as a head crash. And once the head crash takes place, definitely we need to change the entire hard disk. We cannot replace this one. It seems to be like 3D that we can replace one CD with another. No, it's not possible. If you're removing the internal part of this particular hard disk, it is actually present in a rectangular box. Whatever you're seeing here, it is a kind of a rectangular box. So whenever if you try to change, if you want to remove this, we cannot remove it. And if you try to remove it, then definitely we have to replace this entire box. Okay, we cannot replace one of the CD in that and replace another one. Well, that's not possible. It is similar to the CD kind of shape. Okay, I hope it's very clear with this. Now coming to this attachment purpose, how this particular drive can be attached to the system is definitely that can be done using your iBio buses. We have many different types of iBio buses. Based on that, we can connect this particular secondary storage device, the magnetic disk, to your computer. How we can do it means, we have several different type of buses here, like again, ATA. ATA is nothing but your advanced technology. It's advanced technology advancement. So basically, ATA is nothing but it's an advanced technology advancement. Same way, we have something called as SATA. SATA is nothing but it's a serial advanced technology attachment. These are the different kind of bus. I think USB is very much, you people might be familiar with USB, universal serial bus, what we actually use. And again, we have fiber channels. Okay, fiber channels are very high speed channels, what we have. Then we followed with that, we have SPSI and SAS and firmwares. Okay. If you talk about this, what we call fiber channels, these are the ones which are used for your servers as well as your supercomputers, where millions of transactions take place, you know, very fastly the transactions have to take place, and simultaneously some millions of transactions are taking place. At that time, we cannot use something called as USB or ATA kind of thing. These can be used for our personal uses, like for your personal computers, your desktop computers, your laptops, that can be using this ATA, advanced technology attachment, or SATA. SATA is nothing but serial advanced technology attachment. So serial kind of things are mostly used for transmitting the data in a serial format. Okay, so I hope it's very clear till here, but this is related to your magnetic disk. Now, in order to transmit the data between the computer and the system, there should be some kind of controller. So here we have two different type of controllers here, host controller and disk controller. Now, what is the main responsibility of the host controller is, this is present in your computer system, your laptop. Whereas coming to the disk controller, it is present within your external, I mean, your secondary storage device. That is nothing but your magnetic disk. Okay, so whenever some operation has to be performed, like reading the data from this particular magnetic disk or writing a data to the magnetic disk, this host controller should actually send information in a format of a message. To whom? To the disk controller. Now the disk controller, what he will do, he will actually having the control over this particular, whatever the platters we have. So it is the one which is going to perform the operation. It will instruct the internal hardware to perform the operation on this and then send the information back to the host controller. So this is the way how exactly it works. So this is what everything related to your magnetic disk. So here he has just represented whatever I explained it. So that is what represented here. So you can see the different, so you can see here, so we have initially platters. Okay, you can see the platter ranges around from 0.85 to 14 inches, okay, historically. And basically nowadays, as I told you, the platters are coming. What is the diameter of the platter we usually have is 1.8 to 3.5 MMPT. So only three we do have, 1.8 inches, 2.5 inches and 3.5. What is the range of storing the data is from 30 GB to 3 TB. That much you can see. So nowadays in the systems, I mean nowadays the laptops are coming with 1 TB hard disk or 2 TB hard disk, right? So maximum how much we can support is 3 dB. Beyond that, if you're going, then definitely some other kind of device required. And I told you the rotation of this particular drive, the spindle rotates around, we measure it using RPM, rotation per minute. So how many rotations we have? 5,400, it can be 2,000, 7,200, 10,000 and 15,000. And basically these are controlled by the, there should be some kind of controller, right? The data transfer is taking place with the help of a bus. What kind of bus? We have e-buses, right? E-bus, USB, ATA, we have discussed in the previous slide. Then we have discussed about SATA, right? So serial advanced technology attachment. So all these buses should be controlled by some electronic. So the data is transferred using some kind of processor, and that processor is what we call it a controller here. So as I told you, we have two different type of controllers, host controller who will be present in the computer. Disk controller will be making, build on the each disk. So whenever we perform a disk IBA operation, what is saying here is the host controller, as I told you, the host controller will send a command via message, and that message will be reaching the disk controller. He will be operating on the disk drive, perform the necessary actions, and based on that, he will provide the result to the host controller, and he will be displaying that for us. So this is the way how your exactly your magnetic disk works. Now here, they have provided some information related to the spindle speed. As I told you that we have from 4,000, 7,200, so we also have here 4,200, 5,400. So these are the different spindle speeds what we have. We measure in rotation per minute. And they do have some latency, it takes some time. If you take the previous diagram, okay, if I wanted to access the information present in this particular sector, let us suppose this sector I want to access the information, what happens here? First, this sector should come to this read-write position. Either this has to move to that particular position. Then only it can start reading the data information present in it, right? So it will take some time, and that time is what we call it as latency. And that is what he was explaining here, that based upon the speed, the latency will vary. Like if you are using a system which has a 4,200 rotation per minute of speed of a spindle, then it will take around the 7.14 milliseconds of time delay. There will be a delay on average delay of 7.14 milliseconds. Same if you're talking about 5,400 rotation per minute, if you're taking minutes, it was somewhat better than that. So you can see that the latency will reduce. What do you mean by latency? It is nothing but the delay. The delay it is taking in order to access information. So it is reduced. So the more the RPM, the less will be the what we call the average latency what we will be having. So this is what we have actually taken from the Wikipedia source. And then after that, since we are talking about what we call magnetic disk, these are traditional. Magnetic disk, whatever we are discussing now, that is the traditional hard disk what we are having. But nowadays, actually, if you come across, the technology is getting advanced, right? Due to which what happened, the way these particular devices have been designed has been changing a lot. So if you see the traditional hard disk, it is of some rectangular shape which consists of, okay, multiple platters here like this in this order. And this is, so this is somewhat heavier also, and it can support 1 TB of data and all. But as the technology has advanced, what they are doing right now is they are trying to reduce the size and the weight of the devices that have been designed. So in order to do that, what they did is they come across with something called a solid state disk. Well, this diagram is related to your crucial micron. This is a solid state disk. What is the capacity of this is 500 GB. Okay, so this is much more. This is something like you can see it's similar to your RAM in the same way it is coming. If you see the size is very less, right? So we definitely the size is less, so cost will be more. Okay, it is somewhat expensive when compared to your traditional hard disk. But the best part of this particular thing is it is very high speed, means very fast. And that's the reason this particular device is connected directly to your hardware, your computer systems. Okay, why? Because if we use a traditional way of accessing the hard disk like using iBio buses, like we have SATA and ATA, it may reduce the throughput. Whatever the throughput is coming out means what throughput is nothing but the number of transactions are executed per unit time. So here the performance of the system will reduce if you are using these kind of devices in order to access it. That's the reason the solid state disks are directly connected to the system. Okay, your computer system, so that it can be accessed directly by the particular system. So it is much more better. Okay, so that is the best part of it. It is much more reliable also when compared to your hard disk, your secondary storage device, whatever we have. So solid state disks are much more better when compared to that. But even though I am showing you or I am explaining you people that this is much more better when compared to your hard disk, but still it has certain limitations. Okay, don't think that this is more, having more advantages than that. It also has some certain disadvantages. Well, what are the disadvantages? Not drawback, I mean disadvantages, is a con, pros and cons. So till now we have seen the pros, and now we will see the cons. What is the con here is that we cannot provide the maximum capacity using the solid state disk. How much we can provide, like let us suppose 500 GB, not more than that. If you want to show 1 TB and all, it is going to take a lot of time, okay, to design such a kind of device. And at the same time, since it is very, that is one of the con we have related to the solid state disk. What is that is the maximum capacity of this particular disk will be hardly 500 GB or most approximately 1 TB, not more than that. But if you go to the traditional hard disk, like your magnetic disk, what we have seen in the previous, you can support up to 3 TB. But this might be supporting maximum 1 TB, not more than that. Okay, so that's the reason. And moreover, the cost will be more. The more the memory of this particular solid state disk, definitely the cost will be much more higher. You might have seen, if you're not, you can just visit some shopping websites and you can just find out a laptop with a solid state disk. Nowadays, SSDs are getting. If you see there, if you take a 500 GB of your solid state disk, a particular, okay, with an 8 GB laptop, you will be seeing that it costs around like 75,000, minimum 50. So 50 to 75,000 you will be costing it. Why? Because of this particular solid state disk. Means the traditional, whatever they used to have something called as magnetic disk, that is replaced with this particular solid state disk. Because this is much more faster than magnetic disk. And at the same time, they can be connected directly to the system. We don't require seek time and latencies, right? Seek time is nothing but the time taken for a particular arm to move to that particular location. Like in the previous diagram. Okay, I just forgot to explain you people. So we have two things here, something called a seek time. Okay, we have a seek time here. Then we have rotation latency. We have rotation latency. So what do you mean by seek time here is nothing but here, this is related to your magnetic disk. Seek time is nothing but the time taken to move a specific cylinder. The time taken to move to a specific cylinder. Okay, that is what we call it as seek time. What do you mean by rotation latency is the time taken for the disk arm to move to the particular sector. So let me show you once that previous diagram so that it becomes clear for you. You can understand it perfectly. Here, the what do you mean by seek time is the time taken to move to a particular cylinder. Suppose this is a cylinder, right? This particular thing is cylinder. So this disk arm to move to this particular cylinder, how much time it will take? That is what we call it as a seek time. Rotation latency in the sense nothing but if you want to read the data from this particular sector. So this sector has to be moved to this particular read-write head. So the time taken to move this particular sector to the read-write head is what we call it as rotational latency because we need to rotate this. This particular platter will rotate, right? So that is what it's saying here. So the time taken to move or rotate this particular sector, a desired sector to a particular read-write head is what we call it as rotational latency. Anyhow, we have provided it. See here. And saying it's seek time is something, but the time taken to move a disk arm to a particular cylinder. If I have another, I want to move to the next cylinder. This is the next cylinder here, right? So here I want to access the data. So that information, so that access can be done. How much time it is going to take in order to reach there, that is what represented in this particular thing, rotational latency. I hope it's very clear. So this part is not there for your solid state disk. Solid state disk is directly connected to the system. So this rotational latency and seek time is not required. That is the best part. And the next one, what we have in the list is magnetic tapes. Well, basically, these are nothing but the magnetic tapes what we have, but we never use it as a secondary storage device. But we basically use this in a format of a backup. Backup in the sense, if you want to store a huge amount of data, which will be accessed after a very long time, sometime when it will come. So that thing comes under this particular. So that is what comes under called as magnetic tapes. Mostly we use it as backup. Why we are using it only for the backup here is because the access time for this particular magnetic tape is much more slower when compared to your magnetic disk and solid state. Solid state disk, what we are saying, it is very much faster in performing the operation, getting the data from it and storing the data. But whereas coming to magnetic disk, these are much more slower when compared to that. But if you talk about magnetic tape, these are much, much, much slower when compared to your disk. It is almost, 1,000 times slower than your disk. So in that case, what happens, the system may not be compatibly work with this particular thing. That's the reason we use them as a format of a magnetic tape. Mostly you people can see cassettes, the traditional cassettes we use have. They will have a black color strip, right? So that strip is nothing but it's a magnetic strip in which we are actually storing the information. And it's a very, very less. The storage also, how much we can provide is hardly 200 GB to 1.5 TB. So that's the reason. And moreover, the access time is much more slow when compared to your other magnetic disk or your solid state disk. The variation is very much higher, like in 1,000 times is much more slower. It is 1,000 times slower than the magnetic disk what we are using. So it's of no use of using. That's the reason it is used only for backup. And moreover, when systems, the huge amount of data need to be transferred, then this kind of magnetic tapes are actually considered. Okay. So these are the different things what we have. And next we have something called as a disk structure. So we are going to discuss about the different structures, how that a particular disk structure actually has and how it works. So basically, if you talk about the disk structure, this disk driver, whatever you're saying, magnetic disk drive. Here, this is what we represent it as a one-dimensional array of logical blocks. So whatever the magnetic disk we have already discussed, that matters. So remember, we are not talking about solid state disk. If you are talking about solid state disk, then this is not applicable. Why? We are talking about disk drive. Solid state disk is nothing but it is a kind of a RAM. Okay, it's a hardware. Whereas coming to the magnetic disk, it is a hardware which consists of a platter, which is circular in shape. That is flat circular shape. Okay, so that is what we are considering. So here what we can say that particular shape is one-dimensional array of logical blocks. Okay, and here what do you mean the logical block is nothing but the unit, smallest unit of transfer of data. Means you can see a sector here in the previous diagram, that you can call it as a logical block. That logical block will consist of some data. Now here, what is the size of that particular node sector, whatever the sector has shown in the magnetic disk, what is the size it can be? It can be from 1.512 bytes. Since it is very small in size, so definitely it will have a range from 512 bytes to 1024 bytes. That is nothing but your, okay. So its range is very, very small. The size of this particular, that's why it is called as smallest unit of transfer. Why? The size of this particular sector, whatever you're calling, that is what we call it as a logical block. That logical block sizes, you know, the data, I mean, how much data we can store in it is nothing but in between 512 bytes to 1024 bytes, not more than that. Okay, if you want to do more than that, it's not possible. That's why it is called very small in size. And here, this mainly this particular logical block is used for a sequence, the information is stored in them sequentially. If you see the platter, how it is here, I told you that there are different tracks, right? And whenever we are performing operation, the outer, we will try to fill the data from the outer layer first, then we'll enter into the next layer, whatever the layers we do have. Okay, let me draw it again perfectly so that you can understand it. So if you see here, this is the platter what we have. So in between this, we will be having different layers. Let us suppose this is the first layer, outer layer. Okay, and after this, we'll be having another layer. Let us suppose this is another layer. And finally, in the last, we have one more layer. So this is the layer what we have. So if you see here, initially, the data will be filled from this red color layer. This is the outer layer. After getting filled this particular layer, I mean the track, then we'll enter into the next track, that is the green one. And then finally, the yellow one that we have. So this is the way from outer. So outer, whatever the track we have, we'll be having there something called as sector zero. From that sector zero, the remaining cylinder means sectors will be filled. So when all the sectors are filled in a one particular track, then we will be moving to the next track. And every track will consist of sectors, right? So we will be filling those sectors. So whenever we are filling that particular sectors in a track, then we'll go to the next one. When all the tracks, all the sectors in the tracks have been got filled up. So this is the way how it exactly we are going to store. And here, we may not be able to determine. Here, what happens here, the computer plays a vital role here. What is that? If any of the sector is damaged, okay, any of the sector is damaged, the system will overcome that particular problem with the next sector. Means it will try to find the empty sector wherever it is there, and there it will store the data. But it will not let the user know or the system know that some sectors within particular track is damaged. And one more point which you people have to keep in mind here is that the outer layer, just a minute, the outer layer will have more track, I mean sectors, when compared to the inner sector. You know that the distance from the center is much more higher to the outer layer. So it can store huge amount, large amount of data. It will have more sectors. More sectors. But if you talk about the inner one, it will have less number of sectors. And if you talk about percentage, the outer layer can store 40% more amount of data when compared to the inner layer. I hope it's very clear. So it can store around 40% more data. The outer layer can store 40% more data when compared to the inner layer. Okay, so that is what he is saying about disk attachment here. And if you talk about coming to accessing this particular storages, what we have, so basically we can access this particular storages using two methods. One is what we call it as IBIO, another is what we call it as remote host in a distributed file system. Means one is related, this is something related to your laptop, your personal computer or a laptop. Means within your system, a laptop or a PC, you can consider this, and this one you consider it as a server. Like in your personal computer, you will be having the magnetic disk, your secondary storage devices present within your system. So you can access it using IBIO ports. But if you want to access the system, I mean the storage, which is present in other systems, for example, if you take a Facebook, you people are storing all the details related to you in a Facebook account, right? But is that Facebook account present in your system? No. Where it is present? It is present in a Facebook server. The server is nothing but it's a hardware from where some portion of the hardware is given, like your hard disk is given to you, and there you people are actually storing all your pictures, your videos, whatever related to it, right? So that is what he's talking about here. So in order to access that, what do you require? You definitely require a network, and same way you people require a network connection, internet is required, device is required, with the help of the device and the internet, you can access it from the other system, right? So that is what comes under this. So a remote host means that host is not present in your system, it is present in some other location. That's why it's calling it as a remote host. And we basically call it as a distributed file system. And the other name we have given here is network attached storage. But if you're storing the information in your personal, your personal hard disk, then we call it as a host attached storage. Let's have a small look related to it. Host attached storage, what we are going to see exactly here is nothing but here the access for the particular storage device, your magnetic disk or your something called as a solid state disk, you people can access it using an iBio port. Nothing but your iBio bus. We already discussed what are the iBio bus we have, SATA. We have ATA, ATA. We have seen eSATA. Then we have other things like, you know, other one we have seen SPSI. So these are high levels. So using this, you people can access your storage devices. And they are much more faster, okay? Now, remember that every iBio port can support only two drivers at a time. Two drives at a time it can support. Any iBio port can perform, means two way communication at a time, only two drives can access a particular port in order to perform the operation. Multiple, they cannot do it. So here, apart from that, we have, since, you know, technology is changing, iBio devices, you know, if you talk about servers, we cannot use that kind. We need a different kind of thing. So SPSI has been brought into picture. Now here, as I told you, this is a traditional iBio ports can support only how many drives? So, you know, two devices or two drives it can access, drives or devices you can say. It can support only two devices can at a time communicate it. But if you talk about SPSI when it came into picture for the host thing, so this is one kind of bus. Now it can support 16 devices. Okay, within a one cable, it can support 16 devices can access simultaneously. I think it is much more better than your host IBU since it can support only two devices through a single bus. Okay, one bus can support only two devices. But whereas coming to the SPSI, one cable can support 16 devices. This is much more better, right? So this is what it's saying. And every particular SPSI will consist of a target, okay? So we call it as the target, SPSI target. This is the one which actually performs the operation, means transmission of data, getting the data and all will be done by this particular thing. And it is 8 logical units. So every target will have almost 8 logical units to perform. That's the reason it is able to support 16 devices. Okay, means 8 logical units are nothing but the disk attached to the device controller. Means how many devices disk have been attached to that particular device controller. That is saying 8 logical units can be connected simultaneously. So using this, we can use it for our personal computers as well as for your laptops. But if you talk about the servers, now server side means server is also a very big hardware device, right? Now it will consist of lot of millions or millions of TBs of hard disk. Stored in it. So the data has to be accessed, millions of transactions take place from that particular server simultaneously. Then in that case, we cannot use this particular IBO transactions or SPSI. Definitely require something higher, which is very high speed. So there we come across something called as FC. FC is nothing but your fiber channel. Fiber channel. Now this fiber channel is actually a serial architecture. It's a high speed serial architecture. Means serial communication takes place using this fiber channel. It is nothing but it has a speed of a light in order to transmit the data. Now here, this particular C can support up to 24 bit address space. Okay, it has a fabric. Okay, it can support up to 24 bit address spacing, and mostly it is a main part for your storage area network. Well, we will discuss the storage area network. That is the third one in your disk attachment. First one is host attached storage. Then we have network attached, and then finally we have storage attached. So this one, this particular ST plays an important role for this particular storage area network. Now in this we have other variant also, we call it as arbitrated loop. This arbitrated loop is generally support 126 devices, I think you can understand now. 126 devices can be supported by this STAL. ST is nothing but your fiber channel, AL is nothing but your arbitrated loop. It can support 126 devices, well it's a very huge number of devices it can support simultaneously. So that's why we cannot use them in our personal computer laptops because we have only a single device. So we don't really, and within the single device, we might be using 4 or 5 different type of components at a time, not more than that. So it is of no use of using fiber channels for our laptops and personal computers. Where we require this is whenever we are talking about your supercomputer. So your supercomputer, so you are talking about, or wherever you are talking about servers. all your Google servers and your Microsoft servers use this particular kind of strategies, your ST, based high-speed architecture, okay, high-speed cable connection in order to transmit the data, receive the data. And the next one, what we have here is network attached storage. So this is related to your storage information, your storage which is present in some other location. Means your information like Facebook, your Gmail, you people are storing the Gmail. In Gmail, you people are storing all your data as well as your emails. Where you're storing it, you're not storing that in your personal computer. Where you're storing your Google account. Means Google is providing you some hardware. Hardware where you people are able to store this particular information. You know, like same way Facebook. Facebook is providing you some platform, your hardware, where you're storing all your images, your videos and all. So we, in order to access that particular hardware, we need to have an internet connection followed with some laptop, I mean some device, maybe a personal computer, a laptop or a mobile phone. So here that we are going to discuss in this particular scenario, network attached storage. So how we can use it? Well, actually what do you mean by network attached storage here is nothing but this is a storage which is used for accessing the data over the network. It is a special purpose storage which we are going to use it in order to access the data over a network. Okay, so when network means using your maybe internet connection, you might be using it. Now, clients will access it using some, there should be some kind of interface. So I think if people are familiar with remote procedure calls, we already discussed in the second unit. So using RPC, the clients can try to access the information. Okay, if you talk about Unix operating system, they use RPC, that is nothing but we call it as NFS. NFS is nothing but network file systems. Okay. So this is the one which is used by network file systems is the one which is used by Unix operating system. But if you talk about Windows, it uses CIFS. Okay. So Windows file system, this is what we call it as. So CIFS is the one which is used by the Windows machine. All your Windows, whatever the Windows systems you are using it, that will be using this particular RPC. Whereas coming to Unix, it will use network file system to access it. Now this RPC definitely requires some kind of protocol. Since we are talking about internet here, with the help of internet, we can communicate it. So definitely communication takes place. So whenever you talk about internet, only two things should come in your mind. This is related to your TCP and UDP. TCP is nothing but transmission control protocol. Okay, whereas coming to UDP is user datagram protocol. This is what we call it as user. So datagram protocol. Whereas coming to TCP, we call it as transmission control protocol. So this will come in your computer networks in the coming semester. They will be discussing in elaborate way. But remember, whenever you want to transmit any information, you for example, in your WhatsApp, if people are transmitting some data, the data can be transmitted only either with TCP or UDP. TCP is mostly based on connection oriented, whereas coming to UDP, it is a connectionless. Okay, TCP is purely connection oriented. So there should be a cable connection from which you will be transmitting the data. UDP is something like your Wi-Fi. So what are you going to do? You people will be transmitting using a Wi-Fi cable, okay? Over a wireless medium, you will be transmitting the data. So all this will be working on something called as IP networks. So this you people have to keep in mind, internet protocol. IP is nothing but internet protocol, and using this network only, you people can connect to the other devices, okay, using a network. So this is the most important one, what we are having here. So here basically RAID array is the one which is basically used in this particular network attached storage. Using this in RAID, we have different levels here. Based upon the level, you people can try to access the information. Now this is a diagrammatic representation provided for this particular network attached storage. If you see here, we have multiple clients here. Like you people might be using Facebook, right? So at a time, my millions of people might be accessing, you know, the Facebook server. So here, same way it is represented here, the multiple clients are represented. So using either the local area network or a wide area network, they can try to access this particular storage devices. What are the storage devices we have? Network area storage device. They can try to directly access it and perform the different operations. So this is the medium. Here comes the picture of your internet. And whatever I've told you related to your TCP or UDP or the RAID array, that will come across into this particular cloud, okay? So within this, all the network cables, whatever are required in order to access them, will be coming under in this particular thing. And I think you people are almost familiar with your LAN and the WAN, right? Local area network. So that is nothing but your cables. In our system, I mean, in our labs, we do have systems connected with a brown color cable. That cable is nothing but we call it as LAN. So using which we people will be transmitting our data or will be communicating to different devices. Okay. I hope it's very clear till here. The next one is not a part of it, but it is related to storage area network. Means what exactly what he's saying is, rather than accessing the network area structure directly, he will be providing an intermediate in between where he will store the information. Okay, so I'll explain that with the help of a diagram here. You can see the first part here. You can see here, this is similar to your network area storage. Okay, whatever we have discussed, network area storage. But apart from that, rather than directly, so earlier we used to have something called NAS here, network areas. We used to access directly the storage. But what happens here, there comes some kind of infringements related to the security. So to overcome them, what they did is they introduced SAN. That is nothing but storage area network. And it is purely private, means it is totally controlled by the private authorities and it cannot be accessed directly by anyone. Those who log in into it, they only can access it. What about others? They cannot access it. Now here the client, what they will do with the help of the LAN and the WAN, they will be connecting to the server. Now this server will be directly connected to the SAN. And with the help of this, it is trying to, what it is going to do, it will try to access the storage array. And from there, the data will be provided to the client. Means earlier, the client can directly access the data. But now that is not the case. The client can send a request to the server. The server, what it will do, it will try to find the information. So there are multiple storages here attached to this particular SAN. So they will try to get the data from this particular storage array and that they will be representing to the client. So that's what we are doing. We are trying to provide security. Means the client cannot access other data except the data which that particular client is required. Okay, so this is how exactly this works, this particular storage area network. So here also, as the technology advanced, so we are using fiber cables, as I told you in the previous one. In the previous slide, the fiber cables plays an important role for your storage area network. Apart from that, we also have something called as InfiBand. Now, this InfiBand is much more faster than your fiber cable. Yeah, this is much more faster and it is required, mostly used for your supercomputers and your servers where millions of transactions take place per unit time. There we are going to use this kind of thing. Personally, we cannot use it because these are very costly and also we don't require for a laptop to have such a kind of InfiBand where it performs millions of transactions. We might be performing some thousands of transactions, not more than that. Not even thousands, I think in hundreds. So we don't require, but whenever we are talking about servers and high-end configuration systems, definitely it requires these kind of brands, something called as InfiBand. So this is another kind of interconnection, means network IBO provided in order to connect to the devices so that the data can be transmitted easily to and fro, can be done very easily. Well, okay, so till here so in the next session we'll discuss about this particular concept called as disk scheduling. Okay, so for today's session this much is sufficient. So in the next session we'll discuss about disk scheduling and the different algorithms what we have, and we'll see how we can solve the problems related to this. Thank you all for watching.